Welcome to the If Not Now, When podcast series. And I'm very excited because you're our first female guest, which is...
You really shouldn't say that without feeling ashamed of yourself, Amaka.
I am ashamed, but I'm owning the truth because people can see, you know, I can't hide it. Right. But I'm really excited that you've agreed to do this.
Well, thank you for having me. Thank you for the invitation.
Right? So the topic today we're discussing is the Nigerian media doing enough to support democracy, right? So I want to, we'll get into some of this details. But first, I just want to set the scene for people who might not know you.
Okay.
Right? So, you know, Kadaria Ahmed, I know you as the top, one of Nigeria's top, if not the top female journalist.
That's very kind of you.
You've had a very distinguished career working with the BBC, working with various Nigerian newspapers. And I guess I just want people to, understand a little bit about what motivates. Tell us a little bit about why you do this. Right, and why you've kept doing it for all these years.
For 30 years.
Yeah.
I honestly believe that holding power accountable, which is essentially the role of journalists, even as guaranteed in the Constitution, is important, particularly in a fledgling democracy, where often institutions of state that are supposed to sort of provide regulation, that are supposed to, you know, do the, you know, balancing act between people who have absolute power and citizens fail because the institutions are weak. And so I think good journalism at its best essentially is people focused. Mm. It's basically taking into account what works for the majority and using that as a basis, i.e. that's public interest, using that as a basis within which to report, share information that people can use, you know, to better their lives as citizens, to engage as citizens, and ultimately to hold those that we elect into positions of authority. Does journalism succeed in Nigeria in doing that?
That was going to be my next question. I was going to ask, do you think the media is doing a good job of doing this in Nigeria?
It's a difficult question to answer, and the reason is simple. It isn't a yes or no. So we've had our moments where we've sort of been really good and brilliant, but we are also part and parcel of the Nigerian society. So some of the dysfunction that you find within Nigeria has also infected the media. So there are moments when we've been less than stellar in our performance. If I were to sort of... So historically, the Nigerian media, from colonial times, for example, right, was very, very much part of the struggle for independence. If you think about sort of the early newspapers, things set up by, you know, the first president of Nigeria, Nnamdi Azikiwe, all the papers that existed at that time, there was a way in which the media was very much central in setting an agenda for independence, but also pushing out, you know, the messaging, speaking to people in languages that they understand, because we also had vernacular newspapers, right, and all of that. So that was a very important milestone if you look at the history of Nigeria and the media. Then during the military, again, you know, you had people who put their lives on the line to report on the atrocities of the military and to confront that dictatorship. When you think about people like Kule Ajibade, who went to jail, you know, as a result of some of the work that they did as media people. When you think about people like Dapo Oloriyomi, who basically did what we call guerrilla journalism, because it was so bad, they would literally carry mobile printing presses, right? They will print a paper today, distribute it in the middle of the night, and then have to physically carry their press and move to the next.
Because they couldn't stay in one place.
Yes, they had to move to the next sort of safe house, right? And this is not that long ago. These guys are all alive, right? And continue to do so. Dapo Oloriyomi is the co-founder of Premium Times, right? So he sort of continues to work in that space. Kule Ajibade is the co-owner of The News. Right. He served jail time, you know, he was locked up by the military. So again, there, the media played a very significant role. And so
you'd say they played a significant role in bringing in holding the government to account then?
In questioning the dictatorship of the military and forcing conversations about return to democracy. But even after the return to democracy, there have been sort of watershed moments where sort of Nigerian media have sort of stood their own, held their own, and have been sort of a rallying point for setting an agenda for a conversation that is sort of people-led. Mm. When the military annulled the election of the late Chief MKO Abiola, again, the military, the media sort of rallied people around. When we had, you know, although now maybe it would be looked at back in history and it would be like a mistake, but when we talked about subsidy, for example, the protests that broke out around subsidy.
They've
had a few, but you know, what a shared moment.
Right.
They've sort of, so it's, that's why it's not easy to just condemn the Nigerian media. Because historically, they've done quite well. But they've also had really shameful moments.
Yeah, let's talk about that, dysfunctional. Because you said there's been quite some moments of brilliance, and there's been some moments where the dysfunctionality of Nigerian society has affected it.
Tell
me more about that.
So part of what has happened is that when people talk about inclusion in the media, there's a reason why it matters.
Inclusion of
diversity.
Diversity, okay.
Whether it's women, whether it's people with disability, whether it is regional diversity, whether it's because sometimes we can be blind to certain things, not because we want to be deliberately blind, but because you know certain privileges block our eyes from seeing those things. I think when you hear some of the issues outside Nigeria when it comes to race, for example, where people talk about having black people in the media, it's kind of obvious why, right? Because you know then you get people who are looking at issues through
different
the lens of fear and everything.
Yeah.
And to a certain extent, the Nigerian media is a little bit skewed. Mm. So the national media is mostly based in the Southwest. What that means is that there is a predominance to cover Lagos and its axis, and then Abuja. And very little visibility is given to things, say, in the Southeast, things in the sort of remote corners of the north or the middle belt, you know, what we call the middle belt, who don't have as much national media. So there's first of all that issue of you're not even reporting the issues, right? So so that's the first thing, where it's not everything that should be reported that gets into the paper, simply because they are located in a different part of the country, they don't have as many people there, et cetera, et cetera. So that's number one. Number two, the sensibilities are different, right? Mm-hmm. So, you know, the cultural issues, the cultural nuances around certain things. When you're reporting, let's assume you're reporting, what example can I give you? Maybe, I don't know, women issues, right? There's a tendency to be sort of blind to some of the issues that you have in your region and tend to sort of focus on what other regions are doing around women. Meanwhile, there's no region in Nigeria that does not, to a certain extent, have discriminatory practices around women. You know, whether it is around widows, whether it is around children going to school, whether it is around things like circumcision. So they're like, you know, multiple issues. But sometimes you listen to the Nigerian media and you would think that only one part of Nigeria has an issue with sort of the way women are treated. And I think these are just not deliberate things. But I think the worst thing that has happened to the Nigerian media is that we have become fractured along both religious and also ethnic lines. So the fault lines that are deepening in Nigeria are now actually also reflected in our media.
Tell me about that.
I think it's a mixture of different things. Like I said, we are products of, you know, our environment, right? So it's very difficult and it's even costly to stand up and talk out of sort of the popular narrative. I know, because, you know.
So let's talk about, so we're talking a little bit in the abstract.
Yes, we are.
So let's concretize it a little bit.
Okay.
So with one example that I, for example, mm-hmm. and I know you spoke out about this.
Yes.
There was a time not very long ago.
Yes.
Where the media became obsessed. I mean, Nigeria, at least southern Nigeria, became yeah. obsessed with a certain group.
Yes.
Right?
Yes.
Fulani herders.
Yes.
And every crime in Nigeria, I'm being a bit facetious.
Yes.
But every crime in Nigeria was committed by a Fulani herder.
Yes.
And I used to wonder, when I read articles, I'll say, how do they know they're herders? Like, are they...
Did they come with cows? Yes.
Like, what's going on?
And then suddenly,
here, right?
There were no longer kidnappers that were from any other tribe.
You know what
I mean? There were no criminals.
Yeah.
All the criminals in Nigeria that come from other places disappeared. And so this is essentially, and for me, this is, I guess, the most frustrating thing about the Nigerian media, because I don't think they quite understand their power.
Mm.
I don't think they quite understand and appreciate that there are people who manipulate the media, whose job it is to actually sit down and whatever. And so an agenda was set, and the Nigerian media uncritically jumped on it, right?
So,
And I remember doing a class, and I did this deliberately. So shortly after, I sort of came out to sort of talk very strongly about basically ethnic profiling and its dangers, because I presented I did a speech, I distributed things. I started getting invited to do a bit of training around that. And one of the such trainings that I did was in Abuja, and I had editors from a major newspapers who were there. And I put up a slide, and in that slide, this was around the time that you had those Ikorodu boys that were doing some sort of ritual killings in Lagos. Well, I think it was like maybe a year and a half ago, where there was some white handkerchief thing. But, you know, there was a lot of ritual killing going on, apparently driven by a group of, I think they're like gangsters. Mm. You know, these street gangs, right? Mm-hmm. Who were killing
cultists
people, yeah,
stuff,
because...
Yeah.
They were using parts to do something that was supposed to make them rich. You know, the police got a handle on it eventually, but this was at the height of it. And also the beginning of the sort of atrocities of the so-called unknown gunmen.
Yeah.
So what I did was, I basically created headlines that said, Yoruba cultists kill people in Ikorodu. And then I did Igbo gunmen, da-da-da-da, in the southeast. And the place erupted. How dare you? What do you mean? How do you know they are Igbo? Mm-hmm. How do you know they are Yoruba? Mm-hmm. And then I pulled out their own headlines that they'd written that said Fulani herdsmen. And I asked them to tell me why this is okay and the other is not. Two editors walked out whose headlines I had used.
Wow.
Two. And refused to stay for the training. So we have to admit that for some people, they don't really care. They may be part of an agenda, or they genuinely believe in what they are doing. And so reason is not going challenge their viewpoint, they're not ready to engage.
Because they haven't been challenged enough internally. And I think that's
maybe,
point,
but the truth is that diversity. That was a room full of almost, at least 20 senior people. Only two walked out, right? So for me, I saw it
as success,
right? Because the other 18 stayed, and we had a very vigorous conversation. We sort of talked about it. We talked about why it is a problem. We talked about what profiling does, and you know the examples of places like Rwanda, where the media, you know, played a very central role in the genocide that happened, and trying to get people to understand that. You know, you sit in your newsroom, you have to understand how important you are and how much power you wield.
So
and
that
power has to be wielded
responsibly,
you know?
So on that note, so I think this is very important. You're saying a part of the problem is that there is a lack of diversity in the media, which can tilt its ability to see things holistically.
Well, that's one of the problems.
Well, the other thing you also mentioned earlier, you talked a lot about Nigeria's history of the media's history of holding power accountable.
Yes.
But then you also said sometimes they're not, this is one of the problems I've had with the media is not reporting the issues.
Yes.
Right?
And get carried away.
I want to talk about why. So,
yes.
So we've talked about a part of why some of the profiling happens.
So there's
because
also,
of lack of diversity.
There's also capacity issues.
Uh-huh. So let's talk about that. But like a little bit, when I say not reporting the issues, so for example, in all that time, we were talking about Fulani herders. There wasn't enough investigation in like what's actually happening, right? Like what is going on in the Northwest?
Yeah.
Factual, yeah. Right?
What's and happening? Even where afterwards, like, it turns out the people that did the crime were not actually Fulani nor right. herdsmen. And we saw that not too long ago, actually, even recently. The train kidnapping in Edo, for example. The government of Edo, and I know this for a fact because we interviewed the commissioner of information. And I was listening to my guys on air trying to hold him accountable because he kept saying, it is Fulani headsmen, da-da-da-da-da-da-da. And they kept telling him, well, how do you know? How do you know?
Yeah.
A few weeks down the line, it's actually turned out the people were arrested because they rescued people, and all of them are locals of Edo. Not a single one that is Fulani. Not a single one that is a herdsman among those. And yet the media that sort of carried these headlines in big letters and sort of announced it to the whole world, I haven't seen
Never
the same retracted. Effort
yeah.
go into retracting or even holding the government of Edo State accountable for profiling. So it has been normalized, right? Because I think whoever set the agenda has successfully turned the Fulani man into the boogeyman of Nigeria, where basically he's to blame for everything that has gone wrong in this country. And it's not unusual, by the way, across the world, when people have problems, their first instinct is to blame other people, and particularly people who are different from them, their excuses, these are the people bringing this trouble. So I am not surprised by it. But I am just worried that media owners in particular, so the rank and file of the media, fine. But media owners in particular, who have addressed directly in some of the things I've written, should know better.
Yeah.
Right? I expect better from them because they're by and large educated, affluent even.
Right.
You know, some of them, Nigeria has been really good to them, right? Many of them have been in bed with past administrations. Have in many ways contributed to this dysfunction, right? At the end of every administration, when the other administration starts investigating, and I suspect we're going to see something very similar when we have new elections now, always as part of those investigations, some media house will show up, some media owner will show up.
What do you mean show up to?
As having collected big money to do
certain
things, right?
Like when the exposés come out.
Yeah, when the exposés come out, when, you know, one administration ends and the other one starts, and they start, you know, throwing up things, there's always some media owner who's collected millions to distribute to other media, who has tried to do all sorts of things. And I mean, we're recording this prior to the elections. I won't be surprised if when we get a new government and an investigation happens, you know, it throws up the names of sort of media owners who've sort of done less than stellar things. So I don't understand their willingness to not intervene, to not put out guidelines, to not ensure that their people are properly trained around why these things are dangerous and how to sort of manage them. NGOs seem to be more concerned than the media. So a lot of the training that is going on now, trying to sort of get people to be competent in the way they report, understanding conflict reporting, how to do it properly. Because many, when you talk, the sort of the first accusation I get is, oh, do you want media to censor itself? No.
Yeah. So just to pivot slightly away from this. So one of the things that I is a part of the problem that culturally as Nigerians, we're too focused on the accountability part of governance. Meaning, this is what I mean, right? Like criticizing, right? Maybe it's a, I want to get your view on this. Maybe it's a holdover from the military era, right? Where I feel like a lot of Nigerian civil society, including the media, feels like it's its job to point fingers. This is bad. And less about educating Nigerians about critical issues. Like, for example, there is, like, the Lekki deep port is about to become operational.
Yes.
There is a rail link. I've had debates with Nigerians who did not believe it's happening, right? It's just they're hoodwinking you, right? Yeah. Second Niger Delta Bridge. We allow, so I don't know, is that a cultural issue?
No, the job of the media, as you know, and as guaranteed by the Constitution, is to do a number of things. The first is, yes, to hold power accountable, but there are other parts of that job that are significant, which is to inform and to educate.
Yeah.
And those two parts are as important, because the idea is that you then get citizens to engage from a place of strength, from a place of knowledge, from a place of knowing. We've become so combative in the way we sort of do our journalism that only that first part dominates.
Right.
But I don't think it's an accident,
right?
I think two things. Yes, there's a sort of residue of the fight against the military, where people had to be strong, had to be militant, had to call
fight
them out
them,
and
yeah.
fight them, you know, properly. But, you know, without doubt, media has also been politicized. So people have started using media houses to advance political agendas.
Yeah.
And what that has meant is that the credibility of the media has been watered down. Some will even say completely lost. So part of their survival has entailed them pitching their camp with one or the other, right? So you they either completely hate the administration, as you know we see with one particular national newspaper, which used to be really great, but has spent the last 8 years only doing a one-way kind of reporting, or you see them become a mouthpiece for the government, and so that public service element is missing from the journalism. And there's a competence issue. So journalists are not generally, we have a lot of, on radio and TV, OAPs, you know, on-air personalities, right? People who don't have any grounding in what it is to do journalism properly. Not their fault, but nobody has told them what the ethics are. Nobody has told them, like, there's a difference between opinion and fact. You know, and the important that even when you do opinion, it is informed opinion. So they mix them all up. Nobody has told them these are the things you do to cross-check and verify information before you take it out. Nobody has told them how to achieve the balance between reporting two sides of a story. Nobody has told them that, look, one of the things you must do when you are reporting is not enough. If somebody says to you, it's raining, and another person says to you, it is not raining. Balance, good journalism is not to say, A said it's raining, the other one said it's not raining. Your job is to actually go out, partly, and check whether it's raining. And then come back and said, even though A says it's raining and B says it's not raining, we have gone and done our investigation and
I
we found
that
out that actually, yes, well, or it rained earlier, but now it has stopped raining.
That's an important point. Just repeating a lie is not journalism.
It's
like repeating two lies on two sides.
So it's not journalism, but people haven't got that level of training. And of course, the finances and the state of the Nigerian economy, these are all things that sort of contribute, because good journalism does cost money.
I want to talk about that.
The good journalism costs money. As the economy has eroded, media isn't doing as well. Just a handful are doing well. So again, the diversity in the space, you understand? So many media owners set up media houses for two reasons: to have political influence, to sort of peddle influence, and then to make money, right? Journalism is often the last thing on their mind. And so because of that, you find that they can compromise. Those two things can then fuel.
Let's talk some solutions.
The media is already changing.
Okay.
Because they've been forced to change,
okay.
right? Because the coming of social media, new media, online media, means that some of the practices that encourage this kind of bad journalism, the traditional media owners are realizing that they are in competition. They're in competition with social media.
I feel like it's gotten worse since social media. Because social media sets the narrative now.
What has happened is that they're now seen as one and the same. So one way is to build your credibility.
You have to be different from social
You have
media.
To be different,
okay.
right?
Okay.
Realizing that otherwise, because trust has been totally eroded,
so
now you have to build it back. Because otherwise, what's the difference between you and a blog? Do you understand?
So the industry has taken a good look at itself.
A few of us have been fighting. It's taken 5 years of lobbying. But finally, we've settled on co-regulation.
We settled on co-regulation
through an ombudsman mechanism. We've developed a new bill of rights for journalists, and we've also developed a code of conduct, both of which will sort of underpin the work of the ombudsman. So we've actually just sent out. So this is industry-wide across broadcast media, across print media, and also online publications that are sort of see themselves as proper journalists. So we all came together, and we did a lot of brainstorming. It's a conversation that's been going on for years, but finally came to a head last year. So we held workshops, with media owners. We had meetings, and it culminated late last year in a meeting in which we adopted a co-regulation mechanism that includes an ombudsman. So
how will you enforce it?
So the beauty about it is that you couldn't do it if you didn't have the buy-in of all the media houses. So all the media houses now agree, right? So we've just sent out letters and have appointed an ombudsman. Unfortunately, I can't tell you who it is, right?
But that person will be in charge of making sure everybody's playing by the rules.
He has other people working with him because we didn't want to regulate ourselves.
Right.
So we brought in people from other industries. And the industries will change, because they have terms that they serve. So the ombudsman is a sort of very well-respected senior journalist who sort of, he understands the job. And then there are people sort of, there's a lawyer, there are people sort of from NGO community and all of that. And the once the ombudsman mechanism is set up, essentially, we want to do two things with it. We want to hold ourselves accountable so that people who feel badly treated by the media, who feel that they have not been given a fair hearing, who feel that, all the things that we are accused of doing, they can actually complain, and the ombudsman will look at.
So there'll be a public line.
Yes, there'll be a public line. Look at, the case and either ask them, to apologize, to sort of take it back. There's like a mechanism that's been put in place. The second we think is that once we start holding each other accountable, automatically what's going to happen is that quality will improve because...
But would that be publicly reported? He will be publicly
reporting his findings. Yes.
So people will be publicly shamed. Like media houses that are not following the rules will be publicly shamed.
Yes. It is in their interest to improve the capacity of their people, to ensure their processes are better so that they are not, they don't fall foul. But we also recognize that one of the reasons why it is so easy to bribe media in this country for people to collect money is because people are badly paid or not paid at all. So we've now got a bill of rights for journalists, which media owners have signed on to.
So they have to be paid a certain amount.
They have to be paid and on time, and they have rights over the people who employ them. That thing where you would employ someone 2-3 months and you don't pay them. I was on the board of a TV station. I was invited to that board, and I was told, "Oh, we're bringing you to improve things." And I did 3 meetings, board meetings, and I resigned. So the first meeting I went in, I didn't say a word because I wanted to listen and understand what was going on. Second meeting, I thought, "Okay, let me start engaging." There were things I was seeing that I wasn't happy with. Company was making money, it was being diverted. So it wasn't actually going back into funding media, it wasn't going back. So there were sort of all sorts of projects that were being done. Media projects, but what it meant was that you hadn't sort of taken care of your contractual whatever. The third meeting I went to, the staff had gotten tired and had gone to a radio station and were telling you know, sort of talking about how bad their situation is. And then I walk into the board meeting, and everybody's sucking up to the chairman and saying, oh, they should be warned. They're going against their contract. They signed non-disclosure on this. I'm like, you broke the contract. You've not paid them for 9 months. What are you talking about?
Yeah.
And I realized it was all, I'd been brought to try and whitewash the place, right? And so I resigned that day after that. But they were paying me really well, you know, dollars, right? And staff were not getting paid. Right, so there's a way in which...
So you're saying, that there's enough money in the system to pay people well. It's not like they need
I'm not sure about well,
okay.
But there's definitely enough money in the system to pay them what contractually they've been told they're going to get.
At least that.
Yes.
And then they can work towards...
Because the irony of the media houses that are doing this is that they are some of the biggest.
Mm.
So it's not even the little radio station in a village that is struggling to get diesel, you know, to power its operations. It's the big guys who sort of get government-funded advertising, sponsored programs to do this ministry, that ministry, all of that, and they're not paying.
So, okay. That's very interesting and fascinating, actually. Okay. I can't wait to hear to see the ombudsperson and see how it works.
We are very pleased with that.
But I want to pivot slightly too, because something we haven't talked about here is the government's role, right? So when I say the government's role in, I think one of the problems, and I'm curious to hear your views on how the media can encourage this, but I think one of the problems in Nigeria is the government doesn't do enough talking to Nigerians, right?
Yes.
And when you talked about losing credibility, I see a vicious cycle here.
Yeah.
Because a lot of people in government dismiss the media because they feel the media is not professional. Oh, they're just going to print whatever we give them or whatever somebody else gives them, or they have an agenda against us. So why should we talk to them? They're not going to carry our story anyway.
Ironically, they say that publicly, but then behind the scenes, they are carrying brown envelope and trying to influence coverage. It's actually quite shameful what happens, because some of the biggest, loudest noisemakers in the Nigerian media, I know for a fact, collect money
from government.
Yes, they do.
If that's the case, they do. Why is there so much government criticizing?
Because so here's what used to happen. Let me explain to you what this Nigerian media space used to be when I first came back from England.
Yeah.
And I became the editor of what was then the leading investigative newspaper called Next, right? What used to happen was there was no social media. You had your newspapers, you had your radio, you had your TV. But, you know, newspapers were really powerful. If you're government and you want to influence outcome, you do it through a number of ways.
Mm.
You have your media handlers who have relationships in the media. They call meetings, they call briefings. When people are leaving, you open your duffel bag and you hand them out envelopes that have been stuffed with cash. So then you get your things out, right? In those kind of situations, what you see is you will see 10 newspapers, story more or less written exactly the same. Because essentially is a press release that has been handed out, and we're so lazy, we just repeat the press conference. So you open one newspaper, the headline is the same, the story is, there's just sort of no verbatim, right? So that was one part. If you wanted to kill stories,
you
also had people who were gatekeepers. That was their job. They've built really strong relationships with media bosses, whether it's owners or editors.
Right.
And again, it's just a very transactional relationship. You don't even make an effort to sell. Because, you know, there are lobbyists who do this, but they don't necessarily do it with outright money. They would sort of engage you on the issues, try and sell you the story and That's not what they do. They just pay and whatever. Then Next came, right? And Next would not play ball, right? So a big story will happen. No Nigerian paper will carry it. It will be Next, right? Then social media came. And so the ability to control narrative started slipping out of their hands, right?
Yeah.
The problem is that government still doesn't realize that. So government continues to employ journalists to do strategic comms, which is a totally different, you know, it's a very different discipline entirely. Managing comms is not the same as running a newspaper or a radio station.
Yeah.
But it worked in the past because all you needed to do
was
someone who understands, who has relationships in the media space that could then manage his former colleagues, right?
Yeah.
They've continued to do that, but it's gone beyond that, right? So you continue to see them fail in their ability to communicate properly because they're not really working with people who are strategic thinkers, who understand how to manage information, who understand that actually there is benefits to being open and to being transparent. And you can, you know, present things in such a way to even elicit sympathy.
Actually, you're the first person that is making me think about it that way. Because this is one of the things, I think about, I talk about a lot, which is that in order to drive, if you really want reform, right? Communication is such a big part of that from government. You actually have to be strategic about driving buy-in, creating a narrative and getting people to buy in. And that means you have to communicate directly with people, not just manage to die stories or kill stories, right?
And not sort of issue statements attacking people who criticize you. No, so just so,
and so you're saying part of the problem is that the government just hires journalists mostly to do it.
Yeah.
The Nigerian government has been so bad. But isn't there a tension? Because I hear there's a tension here in what you're saying, which is we have a media that generally doesn't really report anything positive about what the government is doing, right?
I remember
when, for example, there was this road trust, the strategic road trust initiative that the current government did, where they would get private sector to like build roads in exchange for tax credits. I mean, I saw it in the media like 18 months after it actually happened. Right? It wasn't reported. So many things. I could go on and on. So I guess the point I'm making is, how did we end up with a media that mostly criticizes, that doesn't do as much of the informing of issues and more criticizing? If they were really just getting paid by government.
For a while, that was a commercial strategy.
Criticizing government.
Yes.
Which was the commercial strategy.
Yes, because then they'll call you and settle you.
Oh, now I understand what
you're saying. Before I sort of jumped back into journalism, I was a group head for strategic comms for a Nigerian business. And I would wake up in the morning, and I'd get a call from a reporter saying, oh, we've just heard A, B, C, D, E, F. We're about to report it, unless you can. And I'm like, go ahead. Right?
How would the...
most people will... I used to get into fights with my boss until he understood. Because he would call me on the phone shouting, ha! You want us to be on the newspaper in the front page tomorrow? I'm like, this is blackmail. The minute you pay once, you're going to have to pay again. We run a business. Maintenance is part of what we have to do. And so things will go wrong. As long as you're not hiding it and you're telling people, we've started the maintenance, this is how long it will take. That's fine, you know?
Right.
Because there's no... He ran basically a public... infrastructure. Let's put it that way, because I don't want to talk too much about it. But he ran a public infrastructure, and you know, occasionally, the roof will leak, because that's the nature of things, you know. And then the leak happens. Heathrow leaks. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Houses of Parliament leak. But the thing is, do you have like a process for
as soon as it
happens and fixing it? But people will call you and say, we're about to say that your thinking is falling apart.
Yeah.
If you don't, I'm like, go ahead.
Okay, go ahead.
Yeah, but we then handle it, properly.
So back to your solution. How will the ombudsperson address a problem like that?
So
this kind of vicious cycle of... I hear, the vicious cycle of basically the media commercializing its services, so to speak, right? Like, how do you...
So there are two things that are going on. First, let's be clear, this is a long-term plan.
Yeah.
So we're not going to wake up in 6 months and the Nigerian media is fully reformed. It's a process that we've sort of started on, and it will take a while.
Okay.
But I'm assuring you that the media is very much aware of the fact that they're losing their lunch to social media. And so for the sake of survival, it is really important that they quickly begin to differentiate themselves from social media. And I think it's a conversation that is also probably global, right? Because there's so much information out there. A lot of it is misinformation, disinformation, fake news, all of that. But discerning people are beginning to sort of identify media houses, media organizations, media platforms that are reliable. So trust is a currency, whether we like it or not, right? Trust is a currency. And I think it's a question of survival. Right. If you don't fix it, then essentially
you become irrelevant.
You become irrelevant. You can just go on social
media.
Better
than social media.
Yeah.
That's a good answer. Okay, I have two more questions. We're running out of time. Mm. Two more questions for you. One, so does the government have a role in this reform that you're talking about? What kind of government, or what kind of should the government be doing?
So the policy would always sort of help to drive things. Without policy, you always sort of end up in a sort of no man's land. Mm. You know what I mean? So in terms of the media, for example, one of the biggest issues the media has is essentially limited income. Now, the more money and media can make independent of government, the more likely it is to be independent in actual fact, in the way it does its journalism. So if it doesn't rely on sort of government giving it money for advertising, government agencies giving them sponsorship for programs, people in positions of authority doing events and calling them to cover it, which is how the Nigerian media currently makes the bulk of its money. And so part of the problem we have is that if you look at our advertising spend and look at the sort of number of people, so I think globally advertising spend is a little bit over 500 billion. South Africa, which is sort of smaller than Nigeria, has an average advertising spend of a little bit over $2 billion. Nigeria has still not hit $800 million dollars. In advertising. This is a country with an audience of almost 200, right? So if
and much more, and in some ways, lots of different ethnic groups.
Yes,
and groups
because part of the problem with the current system is that a lot of advertisers are actually placing advertising almost blind. So you kind of have a system in place, but it isn't that independent.
You mean a system to know like what ratings are?
It's a decent system, but we've outgrown it because of the number of media organizations in the country. Right. We have over 100 TV stations, you know, radio in the hundreds, radio stations, newspapers. Again, so there's sort of no credible that you can test and, you know, especially now in this digital world of sort of measuring who's watching what, how many are watching what.
So kind of like an external media rating.
So we have, this government is now trying to change that. Now, I don't know, they've left it a bit late.
So that's a policy issue, is what you're saying, that you need better regulation to establish.
You need a policy to establish audience measurement mechanisms
that are now
in line with global best practice. Okay. So that if a brand comes and wants to place an ad in a TV station, they're not guessing.
They
know how many people actually watch that show.
Yeah.
How many, you understand what I'm saying?
So that's what government
missing.
Needs to do.
So at the moment, the Minister of Information, Lai Mohammed, actually put together a group from across the industry, people from advertising, people from sales, people from branding, you know, just across, people from industry, people from media. I happen to be, you know, a member. And we were supposed to sort of come together and sort of help, you know, put that policy together so that they can pass it before they leave. Because it would see an almost instant increase in advertising revenue, right?
Because it's more transparency
So like, advertisers now are spending, but there's just a little bit of reluctance, you know, because you can't really, really tell. You're almost like, you know, is you're playing in the dark with this. It's hit and miss, right? So from that point of policy, yes. But of course, beyond that, Amaka, we need to have education. You need to improve the way people learn. You need to improve generally quality of life. You need to improve people's health. You need to improve people's ability to earn. Because all of that essentially allows people to have a bit of dignity and to be able to then live on the basis of, you know, principles. It's very difficult to stick to principles when you're hungry. Very difficult. So I mean,
so specifically, there's an overall development.
Yes. And if anything, what media needs to really understand is that by reporting sometimes in the way that we do, by distorting it, we're actually adding to the dysfunction of the country. And so on the one hand, we are sort of the people who are supposed to hold power accountable, and we shout and say we want a better Nigeria. But we don't look at how what we do is contributing to our dysfunction, our inability to actually get the kind of government we need. So, you know, for example, the media has spent the last 8 years, and I'm not saying all of them, but doing Fulani herdsmen and all of that.
Which,
right?
By the way, to your, so did they not get paid? Is that why they
I think those are more like, I think there's an agenda and they bought into it because it also spoke to their own biases. And so the inability to understand that we all have biases, right? Yeah. The difference I keep telling people in my newsroom is that we will put a process in place that will ensure that you are aware of your bias, so that when you are reporting, you try and remove it, or you recuse yourself
consciously
you know, to become conscious of your biases. So these things feed into their biases, right? The irony of it is that you're now sitting and you're talking about an election where both religion and tribe are playing a role. You helped to build that
environment. Absolutely.
Where these things are part of what we talk about. You can't spend 8 years, you know, maligning a group of people, and then you expect them on election day to forget all of that and suddenly show up and just vote and not think about all those things. So we have to be very conscious of how we ourselves can contribute to some of these things that we think we're fighting against. But I'm hopeful, because I think despite how it looks, there are people who really care about this country.
I think you made a compelling case that it's about survival.
Yes.
If you don't reform, you become irrelevant.
Yes.
My last question for you, because we didn't talk about this at the start, but people who like to criticize Nigeria and the government often say the media is not free.
Yes.
What do you say about that? Do you think the media is free in Nigeria?
If freedom means, you know, not having interference from government, then
yes.
But then other things are influencing them, like money, like regional politics, like tribal politics.
But
like
you're not. Language. But is there any reason? But in terms of freedom, in terms of not being afraid to say something, hold government to account.
I think we've made progress. I mean, you still see attempts to sort of, once in a while, particularly, it happens less with national media. So if you were to attack one of the sort of big media houses, it would be big news, right? And so they're a little bit wary about it. But individual journalists still get harassed, particularly in the regions where there's less of a beam, you know, of a light on this piece. So you go to places like, you know, the States, some of the sort of local newspapers, some of the local radio stations, and the stories are outrageous. What's, you know, state governors to reporters, locking them up. We've had cases like that because they're not as powerful as the national media, right? So the role that unions play continues to be really strong. We must, you know, IPI, NUJ, Guild of Editors must continue to constantly fight for the rights of the media, and that's why I'm happy we now have a Bill of Rights, because that Bill of Rights covers not just media owners and employers of journalists, but also people in government and people who basically try to interfere with people's ability to do their job. And I think it's going to be a gradual thing. It's a process, but we've started, and I'm hopeful that eventually it will take hold and things will get better. So I'm very hopeful.
Excellent. That's a great place to stop. I'd like to end on a hopeful
Thank
note.
You.
Thank you so much for
Thank
being
you for
here.
Having
this
me.
Was an excellent conversation, and I really learned a lot.
Thank you.
And I hope our listeners learned as much as
I hope so too.
So thank you again.
Thank you. Bye.
Thank you for being a part of today's interesting program. You can learn more about the NESG's If Not Now When campaign at www.ifnotnowwhen.ng. You can also listen to other interesting conversations by visiting www.nesggroup.org/podcasts.